Well, this morning we're looking at the final statement of the Nicene Creed, which sets out what we believe as Christians. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. You may well be aware that the Apostle Paul often wrote his letters to the churches to correct false teaching, and we have an example today in this letter to the church in Corinth, because some of the church members were saying that there is no resurrection from the dead. So we have here some really helpful teaching from Paul as to why the resurrection is not only true, but most important, it's a vital element of Christian doctrine. So this is what he says. If there is no resurrection, then Jesus hasn't been raised. He's dead. Our preaching then, he says, is useless. We have misrepresented God. We are false witnesses. We are liars, because we've testified that God did raise Jesus from death. If Jesus hasn't been raised, he says, your faith is futile. There is no proof that God accepted his sacrifice for us on the cross. No proof that we are forgiven. And in fact, we remain sinners with no hope of eternal life. Death has won. Christians who've died are lost. They've perished. And if this life is it, and there is no hope for an eternal future, then we are to be pitied more than anyone else in the world. And why are you so foolish, he adds, to endanger ourselves every day? What's the point? No, let's eat, drink and party, he says, quoting the prophet Isaiah. For tomorrow we die. It's all over. So don't be misled, he then says to the church. Don't be deceived. Come back to your senses and stop your unbelief. So Paul didn't hold back, did he? But it was important. The resurrection is foundational to our faith. It is essential. Sin, Paul teaches, entered the human race through the first man, Adam, and with it, the death penalty, not just for him, but for all mankind. But through the man Jesus, the Son of God, comes forgiveness of sin, because he paid the death penalty. And through him comes resurrection from the dead and the gift of eternal life for every believer. You may remember that Jesus himself said, I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me will live, even though they die. Paul says that because Jesus was the first to be raised, he sort of compares his resurrection with the first fruits of a crop. The first fruits indicate the nature and the quality of the rest of the crop. You may remember in the Old Testament that the Jews brought the first fruits of their crop as an offering to God, but that was just a token of what the rest was going to be like. So Jesus' resurrection body indicates what those of believers will be like. The first fruits of resurrection. Our bodies will be recognizable, but totally different. Suitable for eternity. Paul then addresses the doubters who are saying, oh, well, how can that happen? Don't be stupid, he says to them. Yes, that's in verse 36. Learn from nature. When you sow a seed into the ground, for instance, a transformation takes place. Up from it springs a plant, such as a golden wheat from a tiny seed. Because it's not possible for our human bodies, subject as they are to sickness, disease, pain, limitations, and death, to enter eternity. But something amazing, something very exciting is going to happen when Jesus returns. Listen, says Paul, I tell you a mystery. In a flash, in a twinkling of an eye, every believer, those who've died and those who are alive when Jesus comes, will be changed, totally transformed. What is perishable will be clothed with imperishable. What is mortal will be clothed with immortality. And our new bodies will be beautiful, dazzling, whole, complete, without any limitations, no flaws, no defects. And we shall bear the likeness of Jesus, says Paul. How wonderful. Now, as a young child, I used to love the story of Cinderella. Remember, she was utterly miserable, rejected, clothed in rags. But then the fairy godmother waved her magic wand, and suddenly she was clothed in a glittering gown, and off she went to the ball. But that's nothing, absolutely nothing like what's going to happen to us. Compared to our transformation, it will be just unimaginable, glorious. What an amazing prospect. No wonder we can start singing 1,000 hallelujahs. Paul says that when Jesus returns, he will destroy all evil and opposing dominions, authorities, and powers. And then the final enemy to be destroyed is death. And he bursts into praise. Quoting the prophet Isaiah, Hosea, he declares, where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? And from Isaiah, the sovereign Lord will swallow up death forever. See, God promised through the prophets that one day death will be no more. No more sickness, no more pain, no more grief or trouble or evil, and no more death. Instead, the promise of eternity in God's glorious presence in stunning new bodies. So we look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. So what will heaven be like? It's always important to find out first what Jesus taught about anything. But although Jesus said a lot about how to enter heaven, he didn't actually say much about what it's like. We know that he said we can only enter heaven by repentance and faith in him, by receiving his forgiveness for our sins and the gift of the Holy Spirit. Jesus stated, I am the door, I am the gate into heaven. He also said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. I pause for a moment. Have you come to Jesus? Have you confessed your sins to him? Have you received his forgiveness and his gift of the Holy Spirit and new life, then you may enter heaven. Jesus compared heaven to a great party, to a wedding banquet. But have you accepted his invitation? Because you can't get in without it. There will be joy in heaven, Jesus said. He also told us that there will be treasure and rewards for those who have loved, obeyed, and served him, and cared for others in his name. But do we know any more? In the last book of the Bible, Revelation, we have recorded the Apostle John's vision of heaven. You'll find it in chapters 21 and 22 of Revelation. Do have a look later. It's amazing, wonderful, if you don't know it. But please remember, the description is pictorial. It's symbolic. It's not literal. So just a resume. John describes the beautiful New Jerusalem, the holy city of God in heaven. Its walls and gates are bedecked with every kind of precious jewel. The streets are made of pure gold. A crystal river, the river of the water of life, flows from God's throne through the middle of the city. On either side is the tree of life with its healing leaves. The throne of God and of Jesus is in the center of the city, and they shine with such glorious radiance that there is no need for any other light. God himself will wipe away every tear from his people's eyes, and there will be no more mourning, no crying, no pain. His people will see his face and worship him, and they will reign with him forever and ever. That's wonderful. What a wonderful description. And that's all ready and waiting, prepared for us. But inevitably, people have lots of other questions. Will we recognize one another? Yes, I think so. Although Jesus was different after his resurrection, they knew it was him. Will there be animals there? That's a very common question. Will there be trees and flowers? Yes, I think so. Like a new Garden of Eden. Will I be bored? No. It will seem that we will have jobs to do, but delightful, exciting jobs, not chores. And there will be glorious singing and worship. Earlier in this letter, Paul wrote, quoting Isaiah, that it will be beyond our imagining or our wildest hopes and dreams. No eye has seen, he said. No ear has heard. No mind has conceived what God has prepared for those who love him. Are you getting excited? I hope so. It will just be wonderful. But in conclusion, Paul wrote this. Therefore, my dear brothers and sisters, stand firm. Let nothing move you. Always give yourself fully to the work of the Lord, because you know that nothing you do in his service is ever useless. In all the present uncertainties, hardship, troubles, and evil, we have this glorious hope, because it's trustworthy and it's sure, because it's what God has promised. And Jesus is with us. He's never going to desert us. He is with us, and he will bring us safely to our eternal home. And Paul said in his letter to the Romans, I consider that our present sufferings are not worth comparing with the glory that lies ahead. So then, let's demonstrate to our needy community by who we are, by what we say, and by what we do, that they can have this glorious hope too. Because we look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. And that's a promise, because God said so. As I said, this is the last one of the Nicene Creed. Ray reminded me before I got up that, in fact, the Nicene Creed is what Christians of most generations will stand up and say. This is what we as Christians, as the Christian Church, believe. And I thought it would be good if we just stood up and affirmed our faith through the Nicene Creed, just to give us fresh confidence and hope to stand firm and to know where we're going. So could I have it up, please? And would you like to stand? We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.